On the coast of the South China Sea lies the Portuguese-named archipelago Formosa, better known by its Chinese name, Taiwan. A de facto country, home to 24 million inhabitants, with its own flag, national anthem, currency, language, and institutions. Taiwan, a mere 100 miles from the coast of the Republic of China, considered a rebellious province that might be brought back under control. Taiwan is being carefully surveyed.
Tous les actes et tous les stratagèmes visant à séparer la Chine sont voués à l'échec et s'exposeront à la condamnation populaire et à la punition de l'histoire.
For Beijing, the policy is simple. One country, two systems. Taiwan must fall in line, but may retain their economic and political autonomy.
Taiwan is on the front line. Taiwan is a democracy guarding against the expansion of Chinese authoritarianism. And Taiwan needs to stand tall in the face of the Chinese onslaught, even though the Chinese government, including President Xi Jinping himself, they want to impose one country, two system model on Taiwan. But Taiwanese always say, no way.
On the evening of the 11th of January, 2020, amid international tensions, large crowds gathered in the center of Taiwan's capital city, Taipei, to watch the presidential election results, a crucial event for Taiwan's future. A record-breaking 8 million voters placed their trust in the independent policies of outgoing president Tsai Ing-wen, Beijing's least popular politician. This victory belongs not just to Tsai Ing-wen, but to an entire social network and internet generation who continue to use these tools to resist the threat presented by China. So-called hacktivists, programmers and engineer militants working together to consolidate a true and transparent democracy currently under construction.
Democracy is a set of technologies, of course, going into the voting booth. All these are mechanisms designed to better reflect the actuality of the polity, that what people perceive the world is, and also what the common problems are and what common solutions are, and to increase the bandwidth, that is to say the available input into the collective decision-making by everybody.
The reality of a political world where the Chinese threat is ever present. Will the Taiwanese be able to stand their ground? How will Beijing react? And just how strong is this democratic experiment in the heart of the Chinese world? Su Weilin lives and breathes democracy. For him, it is a reason for living, the backbone of his Taiwanese identity, an identity he would like to separate as much as possible from his Chinese roots. But can he really do so when the China he is trying to block out is so omnipresent? This distant fantasy land of ancestors, gods, and secular traditions, constantly reminding him of where he came from. Having grown up in the world of free and shared computing, he is undoubtedly one of the most brilliant programmers of his generation, a civic hacker, that is to say, a hacker citizen who is willing and able to get around software and computer protections in the name of his personal beliefs. Whilst China tightens control over its own population through a social credit system that ranks its citizens according to how trustworthy they are, Zhu Weilin's job is to hack without limits, even the state, to make sure Taiwanese institutions are functioning properly. It is precisely this generation who took to the streets to denounce Taiwan's political leaders after endangering democracy by making pledges to Beijing. On the 18th of March 2014, the Sunflower Movement had just begun. Tens of thousands of students gathered in front of the Taiwanese parliament to prevent the approval of a free trade agreement, which would result in total Chinese control over the Taiwanese economy. The law contested by these young people was drafted by the majority ruling party at the time, the Kuomintang Party. Historically anti-communist, but in favour of reconciliation with China since the mid-1980s, the Kuomintang Party wanted to pass the agreement without any form of debate. The protests lasted 23 days. A new political awareness was born. This controversial project sparked an unprecedented movement. For the first time, civil society was directly opposing and confronting China. Change was on the horizon. Born of a new country, these are the lyrics sung by Sam Yang, lead singer of the band FireX in their song Island's Sunrise, a song that has become the anthem and rallying cry of the Taiwanese youth.
Oh, 我想起来，那时候我有翻到外面的广场，所以我就会很明确知道，这个目的就是说要让更多人在这首歌产生共鸣，然后去对这个运动产生凝聚力，那就是目的。 那在一个民主化的社会里面，如果大家对于政治是冷感而且避而不碰的话，那其实很容易是一件很可惜的事情，而且你还是会让整个社会走回专制，这是很恐怖的事情嘛。Taiwan's
contemporary history is intrinsically linked to China. It is also linked to the fate of one man in particular, Chiang Kai-shek, who ruled over both China and Taiwan with an iron fist. Back in 1949, a deadly power struggle and civil war had been ravaging China for almost 20 years. Two camps going head to head. On the one hand, the communists led by Mao Zedong, and on the other, the KMT nationalists, who ruled over the country at the time, led by Generalissimo Chiang Kai-shek. In this civil struggle, the Chinese nationalist leader felt confident he could count on the support of the World War II victors, with America leading the pack. But it seemed as if nothing could prevent the communists' relentless advance. The situation was chaotic. Mao proclaimed the birth of the People's Republic of China, whilst for Chiang Kai-shek and the nationalists, the clock struck exile, with nearly 2 million of them abandoning their homeland.
Chiang Kai-shek s'est réfugié dans la grande île de Formose, qui devient une sorte de protectorat américain. Car les États-Unis s'obstinent à considérer le généralissime vaincu comme le seul gouvernement légal de la Chine.
And so, two opposing Chinas faced each other on either side of the Formosa Strait, communist China on one side and Taiwan, the only China recognized by the United Nations, a true military dictatorship on the other. Each of these two Chinas declaring its legitimacy over the other. Annetta Lu is one of the most famous victims of the dictatorship. A longtime feminist, she spent 12 long years locked away in one of the Generalissimo's jails. In a museum dedicated to her are memories of a lifetime of suffering and struggles, but also her victories.
This is my think tank. We wrote a lot of books, all about supporting Taiwan more democratic and advanced. 各种书的记录。这就是《美丽岛杂志》，我们办了四期，结果就抓去坐牢。我们讲民主万岁，long live for democracy。 所以有30年的时间，台湾的民主运动都是在坐牢的代价之下进行的。那所谓戒严统治的意思，就是一般民主国家人民可以享受的自由都没有了，你没有言论自由，那么媒体没有报道的自由，也没有集会结社的自由，没有批评政府的自由，所以我们大家呢。 只能乖乖的都听政府的意见，所以他们跟他们的父母吵架，因为很多的父母还是怀念中国， 叫他们票要投给另外一个候选人。可是年轻的这一代说，不对，我是属于台湾的，台湾是自由的，台湾是民主的。
But what is it that separates the Taiwanese youth from their parents, often supporters of a friendly reunification with China and nostalgic for days gone by? Parents for whom democracy is all well and good as long as it pays. The nationalist dictatorship of the Kuomintang party coincided with the economic golden age, the era of made in Taiwan,double-digit growth rates and cheap labor benefiting the West more than anyone else.
Les conditions de travail dans ces usines, travaillez combien d'heures par jour?
Normalement 10 à 12 heures par jour et 7 jours par semaine.
Ils n'ont pas de jour de repos?
Ils ont par mois 3 jours maximum.
From the early 1960s to the early 1980s,Taiwan became one of the four rapidly industrialized Asian tigers exporting goods around the world. Its inhabitants became richer and started to get used to a more American way of life. Baseball was even promoted as the country's national sport. For the majority of Taiwanese people, a good economy means all is going well.
因为我相信透过了解台湾过往的独裁的历史，我们了解独裁政府所造成的威胁以后，越了解集权政府，我们就越了解集权政府带来的危害，我们就能够守下我们的台湾的民主。有民主我才能赚很多钱，那如果民主不能让我赚钱的时候，独裁可以让我赚钱，那我就拥抱独裁没有关系。但是又有另外一些人会觉得说，真正的民主是让我们可以拥有自由选择领导人的民主，可以让我们去批评政府，或让我们拥有人权。那这个其实在台湾的年龄层就可以看到，其实有非常大的一个的差距。
Three times a year, Zhu Weilin leaves Taipei to travel over 180 miles south to his childhood home on the west coast of the island.
哦，你回来了，哎。刚到啊，啊，行李先放着了，自己到自己到。
Back to the very conservative, pro-Chinese family environment he grew up in. 我真的不晓得要怎么。As always, he is dreading the inevitably heated arguments with his father.
你是36了，爸妈再怎么样建议你，你只能够做参考而已啊。我也不能说改变你了，你跟我不一样啊，我们自己受的苦我们不希望给你啊，你看看我跟妈妈两个一直在就是要给你们好的生活，可是来讲的话你的阿祖一直进希望我们离开政治，你懂吗？
那我觉得这个最重要就是中国他一直都有想要在台湾或香港做些什么，那这些东西对中国是有利的，但对台湾跟香港不一定是有利的，但是在这个过程中他并没有去有一个让大家讨论的机会或时间，他反而是他要什么然后他就压着那个有钱人跟政权去压着这个社会一定要怎样，那这件事情是让大家反感的，才会开始有那么多人去反弹，我觉得他是一个反作用力的状态，
可能要有付出大家很多的代价，因为还别忘记了民主的背后还有一个很大的支撑力，那就是经济。好，这个来讲的话，当我的经济不足，我哪有时间去谈民主？
What can be said to his father, who having survived the dictatorship, is more than willing to sacrifice some of his individual freedoms as long as he's able to fill his pockets? Whilst one party yearns for a sort of paradise lost with the advent of democracy in the late 1980s, the other speaks of political transparency. It's an abyss rather than just a generational gap, an argument that will go on for all eternity.
我心中所期待的开放政府其实会需要三个不同的角色来做到。第一个呢是愿意参与的民众，
愿意参与的人民，他愿意来这个地方贡献他的时间跟他的智慧来把这件事情做好，这是一个重要的角色。再来呢，要能够说出第一线真实遇到困难的公务人员，因为有这样的公务人员，大家才知道说第一线到底发生了什么事情，大家才不会用自以为是的想象来解决问题，才不会把事情弄糟。最后一个呢，是愿意给予资源的，还有愿意承接最终结果的政治人物。政治人物他要能够呢找到资源，然后来到这个会议来提供这个场域让大家来做讨论。另外一方面呢，当大家有讨论结果以后，他要能够承接这些讨论的结果去落实在公务体系里面，要大家照着去做。
Su Wei Lin picked up his concept of extreme transparency from his mentor, one of the Sunflower Movement's key players. His mentor is the perfect reflection of the administration that Tsai Ing-wen has been creating ever since she came into power. Audrey Tang, 39, a former civic hacker,is one of the top 20 most influential people in the world of open source. Since 2016, this transgender minister has been attempting to reinvent the very nature of politics.
As a digital minister, is first to show that a government is not a black box. And so what I'm trying to show here is thatIf we can have the career public service have more direct conversation with people in a more effective way, they can also sympathize with the people more, so the government can trust the citizens more. And once the government trusts the citizens more by being more transparent and accountable, some citizen will want to participate because whatever they offer, they can see how it's translated into real policy.I only film because you film, and people who view the work that we do have a much more balanced idea because behind a traditional camera, the person holding the camera is invisible to the audience. So what I'm trying to do is to restore the balance so that people can see both sides of the camera. And then make sure that people can feel that they can also be you or they may. That means includes more people potentially into this conversation.
Tonight, the digital minister is going to the recording studios of the Night Night Show, a satirical infotainment show that premiered in 2018. Brian Tseng is the host of this talk show and famously doesn't take it easy on his guests, something that has propelled his show to the top of the country's most watched list, a political phenomenon watched by millions of young internet users who revel in the host's sharp honesty.Only one person has been missing from Tseng's list, Audrey Tang, who he's nicknamed the Digital Woman.
指挥命，所以没有上下，是？你觉得有办法达到吗？
现在就已经达到了，我没有下命令，也没有接受命令了。Anarchism 这个字它的意思是说，就是没有人去把权力集中。它讲的意思是权力最大，尽可能程度的分散。对，那所以翻成无政府的意思，好像是说事情就没人做了，但是并不是没有人做事情嘛。
是不是翻译很重要？
对，翻译非常重要。对。
A lot of her, the things that she does is really avant-garde. She puts everything on her agenda online. It's kind of like Truman, the movie. And because the idea is for the government to be like an open government. Everyone can see and scrutinize what the government is doing. And it's these kind of ideas that's really making innovations and make, yeah, it's almost like an utopia, like what an utopian government would look like.
In many talk shows, the agenda is set by the comedian, facilitator, and the host and the guest, right? But this opens up the agenda setting power to everybody in the audience. Not only can they discover what other people in the audience are interested in, but they can do so and like each other's questions without interrupting our conversation.
As always, honesty is prioritized. Audrey Tang makes her own recording, hacking the show for 33 minutes and 15 seconds, right under the host's nose, who has no choice but to accept her rules, no editing and absolute transparency.
下一题，怎么在资讯方面反渗透？
是在这样子的情况之下，我是觉得说，关于青年的政策，越多让青年来主导来决定，我觉得会更好。那这个呢，其实也是在资讯方面反渗透最好的方法。因为如果你觉得是由上而下的政策影响到你，哎，你完全没有决定的权利。那这样子的话，关于这个的不实讯息，你就非常容易的去相信。但是如果这个政策根本就是你参加，好比方说像 Let's Talk 啊、Join 联署啊等等的这种方式提出来的，那这个政策本来就你写的、啊，或至少里面有一部分是你写的、啊，那这样的话当然就不可能被渗透。
各位观众，再次掌声谢谢唐。
Audrey Tang and the Sunflower Movement have birthed a new political culture. In all areas of this ultra-connected society, groups of young citizen activists are joining forces to watch over the proper functioning of Taiwan's institutions. Nothing is taken at face value, even when it comes to the politicians that have their vote.A triumphant revolution, considering that for a long time, being interested in politics could cost people their lives.
When 3.18 the time, that time, I was in the United States writing a paper, so I was writing a paper in the morning and watching a live stream. Later, my family had a relative who was quite excited, saying, "Ah, children, don't worry about politics.不要被民进党洗脑，这样我们认真念书就好。这些都是民进党和那些职业学生搞出来的。因为如果大家对3.18清楚的话，那个运动是反黑箱的嘛，反黑箱然后反清中的一个运动。
Could government transparency be Taiwan's lethal weapon against China? An idea Chi Hua Chu continues to develop at Watch Out.One of the country's first activist collectives, consolidating Taiwan's young democracy to further separate themselves from China. Each and every word spoken by a politician is verified and hence confirmed or discredited. A colossal task. No less than 10,000 pieces of so-called toxic information are identified on a daily basis over approximately 30 popular Taiwanese social networks.
我们相信台湾，我们会认为台湾的民主如果可以在至少一个 最低的底线是所有的政治人物或是人民在讨论是公共事务的时候是基于至少是基于正确的事实，那做及时的 fact check 才能够来去阻止那些错误的资讯，然后被这样传递出去。
It is January 2020, and the candidates are making their final speeches before the election. One argument against another, everyone is trying to persuade and convince.
保护
调查高雄选前选后的债各多少？
就是我们在做 fact check 的时候，我们在直播的当下的时候，我们其实有释出一个文件，就是让大家可以在这个文件上面一起提供。 或者是一起找各种可能有问题的部分，那我们就是用一种公开协作的方式，然后大家就可以，那这边其实就可以看到他们很多人甚至是自己在这边打之后，这个文件上面的东西我们都没有打过，全部都是民众在上面做的。那我记得在我们在做 fact check 的时候，这个上面大概有100多人同时在打字。
Despite its many efforts to differentiate itself from neighboring Greater China, the de facto country of Taiwan has been sitting on the bench for the past 50 years, notably absent from international organizations and assemblies, a petrified country, constrained by its own history. Even the world's major democracies have turned their backs on it. Despite the fact that it possesses all of the attributes of a sovereign state, Taiwan currently only has the support of 15 small states, the most significant of these being the Vatican. But for how much longer?
We can try to understand the reason why they don't want to recognize Taiwan officially. There's always a document in the process of recognition of the PRC as a sole legal representative representing China. And they also think that China is a big market for them to do business with. So, you know, a few years ago, we still experienced difficulties in trying to expand our relations with federal democracies because they think that they don't want to offend China.
But Xi Jinping's China is not solely responsible for Taiwan's current diplomatic isolation. Chiang Kai-shek and Mao's battle to reinstate their vision of the one and only China that could exist on the world stage had a tremendous impact. For Taiwan, this story took an essential turn on the 25th of October 1971 at the United Nations headquarters. After a historic and heated plenary session, Communist China became a member of the UN, making it simply impossible for two Chinas to subsequently coexist in the assembly. For the historic rivals Mao and Chiang Kai-shek, China remained one indivisible entity.
In view of the frenzy and the irrational manners that has been exhibited in this hall, the delegation of the Republic of China has now decided not to take part to any further proceedings of this General Assembly.
After 26 years of UN participation, Taiwan closed its doors not to return again. The principle of one indivisible China leaves Chiang Kai-shek's dreams of reconquest shattered, crushing all hopes of returning to his native land. Yet looking back, it's clear that it was two very separate Chinas facing off against one another at the time, using intimidation tactics and propaganda on either side of the Taiwan Strait.
De part et d'autre du détroit, d'immenses haut-parleurs diffusent des slogans contradictoires.
Despite reoccurring military tensions, both sides continued to flex their muscles. But did the Taiwanese really have a choice?
Taiwan 被逐出联合国的过程中，是蒋介石错过了双重承认的机会。当时很多国家是提出来，只要台湾不要再宣称代表中国，让台湾跟中国同时成为联合国的会员国，是被允许的一个选项。当时蒋介石拒绝了。
A decision that sealed the fate of the entire country, causing shockwaves still felt today by the Taiwanese population. Chiang Kai-shek and Mao's determination forced the international community to acknowledge the idea of one united China. But is the world paying the price today?
最近的武汉肺炎，那个 WHO把台湾的疫情的统计放在中国这个项目底下，跟香港、澳门放在中国这个项目底下，但是事实上，台湾的疫情控制跟中国的疫情控制是有 非常截然不同的差别。
I'm not sure whether there will be a political recognition or diplomatic recognition in the future, but I think the political trend is there, that the political relations or diplomatic relations between Taiwan and European countries or federal democracies are getting better and better. And we can certainly hope that one day Taiwan will be recognized by the federal democracies as a member of democracy. That Taiwan is a member, a state that is on the equal footing as other democracies.
For Audrey Tang, Taiwan's absence on the international scene can no longer be justified. So the digital minister has come up with a solution. Her one hope? The internet, the embodiment of 21st century internationalism, its main asset being the ability to create a perfect digital copy. Farewell to Taiwan's past, and hello to even stronger resistance against Beijing's diktat.
Minister without portfolio Audrey Tang delivered a speech at the UN's annual Internet Governance Forum in Geneva late last week, making a diplomatic breakthrough for Taiwan. As expected, a Chinese diplomat gave a typically angry reaction.
Many developing countries have requested that Taiwan share its advanced e-government experience to help them provide more convenient services for their own people.
This is very inappropriate. It is not a place for people to advocate one China or one Taiwan or for Taiwan independence.
Let me just say that we are not talking politics here, we're just talking policies.
I have done so repeatedly in many, say, UN venues or various different multilateral organizations and high-level meetings and so on, because mostly the jurisdictional control occurs at passport control, but a robot does not need a passport, and because of that, my robotic double can go anywhere that has a broadband connection. And to me, that is the main space of international negotiation, but that's because I'm digital minister. What we are doing in Taiwan, the civic hacking and the democratic innovations can certainly be applied by those older republics and democracies in a way to kind of cure this apathy to democracy.
Far away from these diplomatic concerns, life flows calmly and smoothly. A comfortable life with scenery that could be from a postcard. But beyond this apparent tranquility, a very tangible threat hangs over the country. In July 2019, Taiwan purchased over $2 billion worth of weapons from the United States.
We will try to avoid potential conflict in between the two sides, either in our languages, statements, or in our actions. We'll try to avoid war. And unfortunately, Taiwan is located so close to China, and they've been having all kinds of propagandas on Taiwan, and therefore we are concerned that the war might break out, not because of Taiwan, but because China wants to resolve its own domestic problems.
Over the past year, China has demonstrated its methods of managing domestic issues in Hong Kong. The promise of one country, two systems, the same model Beijing is offering the Taiwanese, has been proven empty. More ominously, China has passed a law condemning a life sentence to any political opponent in Hong Kong. The Chinese threat to Taiwan is ever present as China continues to destabilize its institutions. Today, the Taiwanese authorities are fighting a technological war from the National Center for Cybersecurity Technologies. Thank you. With no uniform or military medal, Qian Hangwei is the chief of staff of a hidden army in charge of countering the 5 million cyber attacks that strike Taiwan on a daily basis. Financial institutions, power plants, hospitals, schools, all constantly under threat.
所以当我们在讲说台湾其实是在整个网络攻击尤其是中国的网络攻击的最前线的时候，那通常当我们有发生这些攻击的自然事件的时候，那我们会去分析它的一些特征。所以其实就有点类似指纹的概念，每个城市总是有它的特殊性。譬如说，一个礼拜七天来讲，那可能礼拜一到礼拜五 就会有攻击，可是礼拜六、礼拜天没有。那在一天里边，我们发现到，比如说九点，它的攻击是开始增加的，那一直到中午的时候，它的攻击就开始减少。那到下午大概两点多，攻击又开始增加，然后到五点多，那它的时间，它的攻击的次数就减少。其实它是有规律性的。
我的音觉就是停留在刚刚，就是他说他们收到一些可疑的 email， 然后，你要我们回复他，就给他一些建议，请他可以检查一些
log 嘛，然后也可以通知他一些客户的部分。我们在描绘的一个概念，就如同刚才说的。 我们发现到很多对台湾长时间的攻击，那长时间的攻击，尤其是攻击成功以后，那这些攻击成功的结果，其实它会去做转化，然后它就会到其他国家去做攻击，包括像欧洲的国家或是美洲的国家。所以我们讲说，台湾等于是在网络攻击的最前线的意思，其实是在于说，台湾等于是 一些网络攻击的一个试验场域，好，那他们来试。好，这我自己的看法。比如说举例来讲，好像广义的这种 cyber attack， 包括一些讯息、一些 disinformation 的部分，其实它会让民众对政府、对彼此失去信任，甚至对于整个民主的制度失去信任。那这个是我认为治安对民众很重要的一部分。我的看法是这样，所以我会认为治安其实越来它会是在整个生活的一环。
The pressures exerted by China on a daily basis continue to define and impact the lives of these island inhabitants. Here, it feels like a very stark choice, whether you are for or against China. Sam Yang has clearly picked a side, using culture as a political weapon. FireX's choice to sing in Taiwanese, the local language spoken at home that Chiang Kai-shek once attempted to replace with Mandarin, is an insult directed at Beijing.
Is 真正我觉得感受到明显的，他们的动作其实是2015年我们拿到金曲奖的时候，他们的转播在颁发这个歌曲的时候，颁奖人打开信封，然后发现是我们得奖，马上对岸就断讯了，所以这个是唯一可以呈现的证据啊，对，所以这是很危险的事情，如果在这一些 如果在这一些市场跟金钱的前提之下，一个又一个的艺人去做出这样的妥协的时候，其实你说这个其实就是对民主社会是会有很大的伤害。
所以觉得台湾很自然的
不只是一个地方的名字，一个岛的名字，而且是一个很可爱的国家，非常民主的，而且非常的可以是全世界的一个魔幻的国家。所以我觉得这是很自然，没有人可以在阻挡这个趋势。
This may be so, but publicly asserting one's Taiwanese identity can have negative consequences. Take Taiwanese pop star Chu Tzu-yu. She was about to become the face of the Chinese brand Huawei in 2016. After appearing on a Korean reality TV show displaying her country's flag, she lost everything, not to mention the public criticism and humiliation.
大家好，我有话想对大家说。中国只有一个，海峡两岸是一体的。我始终为自己是一个中国人而感到骄傲。对两岸网友的情感造成了伤害，我感到非常非常的抱歉。再次的向大家道歉，对不起。
那我觉得我这样的全套构想，台湾跟中国可以变成一个中华民族的一部分，但是两个不同的国家。希望中国跟台湾，我认为就是远亲跟近邻的关系来发展。
Some Chinese tourists, searching to reconcile with their Taiwan neighbors, are gathered here at the foot of the famous Taipei 101 Tower, the most visited place in the capital, attracting hundreds of thousands of mainland travelers every year. Here, some former TIRA idealists, short for the Taiwan Independence Revolutionary Army, fly their provocative banners to set the tone for their dear cousins.
China 来了，是不是？
你看我像哪里？
中国来的，我看你像中国来的。
为什么？看哪里？
口音，一方面口音，这方面一招啊。
你看他为什么老是拍我们呢？我们在说话，他拍我们。
很正常啊，你怕什么？
我当然怕啊。
那你怕，那所以说你是中国，所以你中国人啊，就是心里有鬼才会怕。那我台湾人我就不怕。
那你们，
那所以说民族自由哪个好啊？啊，你要讲台湾要不要独立啊？独立自由自由民主是多好的。
我不能说不同意，因为这个是政治问题，很敏感，这个很敏感。如果我们说话稍有不慎，回去我们就可能蹲监狱了。
好了，有空再来哈。好，拜拜拜拜。This guy is from China。
应该说，中国文化有一句俗谚叫做"人无远虑，必有近忧"。我相信左跟右其实是个远虑，也就是很遥远的时候，我们未来可能会遇到问题。但是对台湾而言，统跟独是我们的近忧。这也是为什么台湾的政治的圈会以统独来做最主要的区分，而不是左跟右来做区分。
现在中国已经崛起了，像一只猛狮，所以我们现在应该为了世界的和平，希望这只狮子要关进笼子里。我们要让所有的和平动物，现在很温和的这些动物应该团结在一起。
A wishful thought, shared by a growing number of Taiwanese people in a society trying to overcome its own generational rift.
像我也没办法接受法国文化，我讲实在话，但是我可以接受。对啊，
杨教官大师是也不会也没错。
对，突然想
起来，对。
哇，
以后人家传输政治理念的时候，
哦，那这个事实上，像我们在小时候讲国语又被罚钱，这个是我们非常不能理解的事情。那我很高兴，就是说，经过了30年之后，哎，这个文化已经又被打开，然后被大家认识。那事实上，你说台湾跟中国，事实上有语言的关系，但是本来就是两个独立的个体，没有什么需要特别去区隔的。一代接一代，我们家我爸爸我妈妈每一次生日许愿，一定会有一个愿望，希望在有生之年看到台湾独立。 那我爸爸走了，然后我妈妈还在，然后接下来换我们，现在也都是这样子想，这个就是世世代代一直下去，台湾独立。
How will Taiwan ensure the success of its budding democracy, born from the ruins of a nationalist dictatorship barely 40 years ago? Will Beijing's constant pressure get the better of the country, desperate to forge its own path? Taiwan's history is living proof of Alexis de Tocqueville's theory, among democratic nations, each new generation is a new people, with all due respect to Beijing.
Sorry.